by sin oppressed, there's mercy. Trust him now, he will
got so many others that lost loved ones that are on Myanmar and Mark, and Elise, on the member Hurt. Remember Phil Nelson. They have found this spot by his heart. They're trying to use it for the heart health and they don't know exactly what it is. But let's remember him. Regina Phillips, which is Carolyn's sister, found and built her back. Gail Jackson, who had the triple bypass this morning. I had a gentleman here awake, and I thought the same comments. She woke up this morning about 4 o'clock. So we keep the call and the
Start out this morning on page 14.
Thank you. All right. It may be wet and dreary on the outside, but man, on the inside, God is still real. How many of you come to worship Jesus today?
Amen.
Amen. He's alive and well. I got a call this week. We've been out of jail now for 2 years almost. We had been able to go in there. They called me this week, and we're going back in starting Wednesday night, the Bible study. We've got a spot for you on Sunday night, buddy.
That's cool.
So anyway, we're going back into jail this week, starting that. Pray for our R6 mentoring program, the house out there, and all that entails. Pray for Aaron. Aaron, as he leads that out there in the house. Pray for him as he endeavors to lead these guys where they need to go. Pray for me that I don't pull the rest of my hair out trying to do that. All right, it is. It's good to see all of you this morning. I pray that you've had a good week. Wasn't it a beautiful, beautiful week this week?
Amen.
I tell you what, some of the people, I saw pictures of different people down in Florida, down there on the beach, but I thought it looked pretty good here. Yeah. All right. Pray for all these women this morning. Vicki lost her dad, and several others had surgery. And continue to pray for Terry and a lot of other people like on that list. There's so many on this list. It's just amazing. But anyway, remember all of these, and remember our church. You know, they say church attendance is down 50% all across the country. Well, I look around, and you know, we're down a little bit, but I don't see 50%. Y'all must love Jesus.
Amen.
All right, let's receive an offering this morning. All right, now let me remind you, we're receiving the tithes and offerings. Your tithes, I want to explain this. Maybe some of y'all don't realize this. Tithes are what is already God's, 10%. Anything above that is an offering. Okay, I just want to clarify that. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give this morning. God, as you take this offering, God, I know that you'll use it for your glory. God, that lives and hearts will be changed forever. We thank you, Lord, for what this offering does. God, as we do all the things we do here at the church, Lord, I know as a preacher, I don't like to even talk about money, but God, I know it takes money to operate it. Lord, I thank you for what you've blessed us so much with these offerings. Thank you, God, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all pray for Robert this week. He gets rid of his old bag. I mean, the bag he carries this week. Sitting around that table, and they'd come by and they'd hit me on the head as they're going by getting their food. And aggravated me. And so I went over there. My brother, by the way, Charlie, he moved down here on 58 Highway. Well, that's where he's going to church, in Jackson Chapel. And I told him before I left the Lord's table, I said, "Listen, I said, we're going to have special prayer for y'all tomorrow. If anybody that put up with him needs special prayer."
Amen.
So we're going to pray down here. Amen, brother. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you and we love you. God, as we receive this change offering, Lord, I just pray once again, God, that wherever it goes this fall, Lord, that you would send it where it needs to be. Lord, it would touch the lives that you have touched. God, it would accomplish what you have for it to accomplish. Thank you, Lord, for this offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all help me with it?
Peter on the rock. He up there already. Here, climb on up. Genesis chapter 24. That helped me.
Yeah.
First book, chapter 24. And now you're wondering what verse, and so am I. It's all good. I don't know where to start. You know, sometimes I walk up in jail, and I'll get ready to preach a service, and then they said, "Where are we going tonight, preacher?" I said, "Just open your Bible, give me a verse. It's all good. I just preach out of any of it. It don't matter." But Genesis chapter 24. Let me just go with the first few verses, verse 1-6 or something like that. It don't matter. I'm gonna tell you the story anyway. And Abraham was old and well stricken in age. And the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house, that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh. And I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I dwell. But thou shalt go unto my country, and to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said unto him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land from whence thou camest? And Abraham said unto him, beware that thou bring not my son thither again. Lord, we understand this passage of Scripture is such a beautiful, beautiful picture of salvation, the bride and the groom. Oh God, help us to see that this morning. God, I pray that you'd open our hearts and our eyes, that we might hear your word, and we might receive it, God, into our hearts and our souls, and we might realize that we too are in this passage. We'll see ourselves in here. But God, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for that servant that he sent. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Abraham is well stricken in years. That simply means that Abraham is old. Abraham has journeyed. Abraham is the one, by the way, that God called out of his home country and told him to journey until he came to a land that God had prepared for him. And that land was Canaan, the promised land. And here we find Abraham is in the promised land. He's among the Canaanites. And if you back up and read chapter 23, you'll find that Sarah has died, his wife. Now, let me refresh your memory. Sarah and Abraham are the ones that God promised the promised child. And they waited 25 years for that promised child. And through the waiting, Sarah got a little bit ahead of God and had a son called Ishmael by the handmaid, Hagar. And that's the one that ultimately Abraham had to put out. She went out in the desert with the Hagar and her son Ishmael. But that's a whole different sermon. But here we find that they are promised a child, and they're living on the promise. And all throughout Abraham's life, they lived on the promises of God. Now, I can stop right there this morning and just share that one little message right there with you, that Abraham lived on the promises of God. And that ought to be enough for us to say, okay, now I get it. We need to live on the promises of God. And that'd be enough for me, because I don't know what you're living on, but I'm living on the promises of God. He promised me eternal salvation. He promised me a place called heaven. He promised me that I'd be a joint heir with Jesus Christ. He promised me eternal life. And folks, I'm living on those promises. I can't wait until they're fulfilled in my life, and most of them are. And so Abraham lived on the promises. He journeyed to a far country. And here in this passage, let me back up, and I want to tell you this because I want you to kind of follow me where I go. Abraham, in this passage, is a picture of the Father. Isaac is a picture of Jesus Christ. The servant is a picture, a type and shadow of the Holy Ghost. Okay, keep that in mind as we go. All right, so Abraham, the father, calls his oldest servant. Notice what he said. His oldest servant, he calls him in. Notice what he said about that servant. He said it, not only was he his oldest servant, but he was the one that was over all the things of the father. Yeah. Boy, y'all missed a good place to shout right there. He was over everything the father had.
Yeah.
In other words, the servant, by the way, the servant's name in this chapter 24 is never mentioned. But if you go back in chapter 15, you'll find that servant's name is Eliezer. And so he calls the servant to the house and he says, I want you to go into a far country, the home where I came from. And I want you to find a bride for my son. Yeah, that's what he's telling. And the servant, he put his thigh, hand under his thigh. In other words, the Holy Spirit got as close to the Father as he could. If you remember, Moses wanted to see God, and they said, no. He said, you're only going to see my hinder part. And so he said, put your hand under my thigh and swear to me that you'll find me a bride for Isaac. But he said, the servant said, well, what if she won't come? Well, notice what he said. He said, what if she doesn't want to come with me? And he said, don't make me have to send my son down to that far country again. Y'all ain't getting this. Y'all ain't getting this. The father told the Holy Ghost, go get me a bride, and if she don't want to come, don't make me have to send Jesus down there again to wait to get the. He already died once for me. Right. That's all he's going to do. And if you're not willing to follow him, you're in trouble.
That's right. Yeah.
And so the servant listens to the master. He calls Abraham. He doesn't call him Abraham. He calls him master. He said, master, what if she won't come? And he said, Eliezer, he said, servant, he said, beware lest I have to send my son again. In other words, don't make me do that. So it said the servant loaded up a lot of good stuff. He took 10 camels and he journeyed toward the land whence Abraham came. He went as far as he could go physically. And he came to a well. Isn't it funny how good things happen at the well? You'll get what you need at the well. If you don't believe me, when you get to heaven, ask the woman that was at the well that met Jesus that day. And so he comes, but before he gets to the well, when he sees the well, notice what the servant does. You see, the job of the servant, which is the Holy Ghost, is to do nothing but honor his master. Everything the Holy Spirit does, he does it to honor the Father. Are y'all still with me?
Yeah.
So the Holy Ghost, he's servant. He sees the way. And he's thinking, the Holy Ghost is thinking. How many of you know the Holy Ghost thinks for you?
Amen.
It's about time for the women to come to the well.
Yeah.
It's about that time of day. Isn't it funny how the Holy Ghost loves to show up right on time?
Yeah.
He knew exactly what time it was. He knew who was going to be there. He knew what was going to happen. But listen, before it ever happened, The servant began to pray. Notice that. Read the story. It said he began to pray. It said, Master, my Lord, I know that you need a bride for Isaac. And he said, Lord, I pray that you'll make this happen. And God, I'm going to be looking. And Lord, if you'll show me and give me a sign, I'll know that this is the right one.
Yeah.
Right. So he got to the well. And he asked him in that prayer, he said, God, if you've got the woman here that's going to be the bride for Isaac, let her ask me to drink out of her pitcher. I said, okay. And so he got to the well, and this woman came out that was fairer than all the other women there. And she, notice what it said. She was a virgin. And she came to the well, and she looked at the servant. When she saw the servant, when their eyes met, something about that servant caused her to think differently than she ever had before in her life. She looked at the servant and said, can I get you a drink of water?
Yeah.
In other words, the servant, as he looked at this woman, the Holy Spirit of the Holy Ghost caused her to ask that question, can I do something for you? And the Holy Ghost, I know what the servant was probably thinking. Honey, if you knew what I could do for you, you wouldn't be asking me that question. The same question Jesus told the woman at the well, that if you'll drink from this water, you'll understand who you're talking to. If you knew who you were talking to, you'd drink this living water that I have for you.
Amen.
And so, Rebecca said, can I get you a drink of water? Remember this prayer? And he said, not only is she going to ask me for a drink of water, but she's going to water my camels too. Yeah, that's what he prayed. She said, God, show me a sign. And as soon as she got to the well, she went up. Listen, the woman, the bride, met the Holy Ghost, met the servant.
Yeah.
They were on the same page together.
Yeah, right.
How many of you remember when you met the Holy Ghost in your life, and God prompted your heart, and you begin to commune with the Holy Ghost like you've known Him all your life? That's what the Holy Ghost does. When He calls you out of darkness into the light, you begin to see who He really is.
That's right.
And so, she asked Him, said, can I get you a drink out? Would you drink out of my pitcher, sir? And could I water your camels too? Now wait a minute, he had 10 camels. It took a lot of water to water 10 camels.
Yes, sir.
It says that a camel drinks 8 to 10 gallons of water at a filling. And he had 10 camels. Now you do the math. And all she had was a little pitcher. And she, I think you didn't have a picture of it. She got that picture, and she's filling this trough with these candles. In other words, she's doing what the Holy Ghost instructed her to do. She asked if he could. Can I? And he said, yeah, water my camel. You see, when the Holy Ghost gets inside of you, when you meet the Holy Ghost, when you meet the servant of God, He causes you to do things that you wouldn't ordinarily do.
That's
what He wants to do. And so Rebecca is watering the camels, and then the servant begins to pray again. He's praying to himself. Lord, I believe this is the one. And Lord, I'm gonna ask her a question. And God said, go ahead. I believe this is the one. And he after she waters the camels, he looks at the woman. And he asked her this question, and this is the same question that the Holy Ghost has asked you at some time in your life.
Yeah. Amen.
Whose daughter are you?
Yeah.
Who do you belong to?
Yeah.
That's what he asked you. Who do you belong to? And then in the same sentence, he said, is there room in your house for the servant? Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Oh, y'all missed that
one
there. Is there room in your house for the servant to come and abide with you? When the Holy Ghost arrested you and began to save your soul, brother named Ethel. And she said, there's room in my house for you. He said, what about my camel? She said, oh, we'll make room for everything you've got. See, y'all missed it right there. When the Holy Ghost comes and starts to abide in you, we said, well, I'll take a little bit Monday, and I'll take a little bit Tuesday, and I'll take a little bit Wednesday, and Thursday, and Friday, and Saturday, but I'll get my biggest dose on Sunday. Don't give me too much of your Holy Ghost until Sunday morning when I get to church. Listen, we ought to be filled with the Holy Ghost every day of our life, thanking Him for what He's done in our life. When that servant moves into your house, it changed your life forever. So, the next thing the servant does, he said, come here, girl. Boy, I like it when the Holy Spirit says, come here. He put a ring, earring on this woman, Rebecca. And then he put bracelets on her hands. Now you think, well, preacher, what does that mean? Why would he put all that gold stuff on her? Remember who he is? He's the Holy Ghost. And he gave that woman these gold rings and these golden bracelets and said, honey, these are blessings from my master.
Right.
Yeah. And this ain't nothing compared to what he's got in store for you.
Yeah.
Now, you think my master owns the cattle of 1,000 hills, if you think these little gold bracelets and earrings is something worth, listen, he's got way more than that for you. If you'll come and you'll go with me, you'll find out that my master owns everything in the world. Oh, listen, he sent his servant, the Holy Ghost, to receive the bride and to be adorned, the bride, with bracelets of gold. How many of you today are adorned with the grace of God in your life? That's better than gold and silver. Listen, he's adorned you with everlasting life. She put on the bracelets. She put on the earrings. And she said, come on, servant. Let's go to my house. Mm-hmm. Oh, how many of you remember the time?
Yeah. That's right.
That the Holy Ghost met you.
Yep.
And you said, come on, servant. Yeah. Let's go to my house. You see, some of y'all may not get that, but when the Holy Ghost arrested me, I couldn't wait to get into my house.
That's right.
Because I had kids in my house that were lost.
Yeah.
And I wanted them to see what the Holy Ghost had done to me. Yeah. I wanted them to see that I wasn't the same old nasty, filthy man that I used to be. And that overnight, he had changed me. He had begun to work on me. I wasn't changed overnight, but he began to work on me from that moment I met him.
Yeah.
And he adorned me with the greatest precious jewel called grace and mercy. And when I walked out of that church, I walked out of it a different man. I've never been the same since. Why? Because I met the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
I met the servant of God. And he adorned me with the grace of life.
Amen.
So, she put on the earring and she put on the bracelets. And she comes to her house. And Laban and her brother come out to meet the caravan. The Holy Ghost and 10 camels and a woman. Yeah, that's what it was. So, the first thing he noticed, read scripture. What's that you got on?
Yeah.
Rebecca, you look different.
Yeah.
You got some earrings on and you got some bracelets. Where'd you get them?
Yeah.
I said, oh, you should have been with me up the way. You should have seen what this man gave me and what he promised me. You see, when you have an encounter with the Holy Ghost, the world sits up and takes notice. They see something in you that they never saw before. Oh, listen, I remember when I got saved, I had a beard down here, hair down to here, and I sat on the pew the next Sunday, and the old deacon come by, he shook my hand, and he said, son, it's good to see you. I'm glad you're visiting with us. Have you ever been here before? I said, sir, I was saved last Sunday. I cut my hair. I said, no, I feel that same guy on the inside, but on the outside, God did his grace on my life. Folks, listen, that's what when the world sees they see what the grace of God, the Holy Ghost has done in your life. The Holy Ghost asked the woman. He told her the story. He said, "Man, my master has sent me to get you. My master has sent me, and he gave you just a little sample of his riches to give you." How many of you know the Bible says that great are his riches in mercy for us?
Yeah.
And he said, I just give you a little sample of what God has in store for you. Then he asked her a second question. I know that you've never met the Son. I know you've never laid eyes on him. And I know that you're kind of afraid. You've never been away from home. But he said, if you're prompted, if you're willing to follow me, the servant, would you go and become the bride of the son of my master?
Right.
That she'd never seen him. She'd never heard of him. She didn't know what he looked like. She didn't know who he was. But she met the servant.
Yeah.
You see, everything this servant did in this story glorified his master.
Yeah.
That's all he was doing, was glorifying the father, Abraham. And so the woman looked at him after she had seen all the riches, the gold bracelet, and she looked at him, but there was something, she didn't really care about that stuff. When she looked at him, he asked her that question. Will thou go with the servant? Will you come with me to a far country and become the bride of a man you've never met? Will you serve him? Will you follow him? Will you follow him until you at all? Listen, he said, I know you don't know him. I know you've never seen him. But if you agree to follow me, the servant, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, I will show you who he is. And one day you'll get to meet him face to face. Oh, y'all ain't getting this. You see, the Holy Ghost, when he came to me and he said, I know you don't know it. I know you've never seen him. But if you'll trust me and follow me, the Holy Ghost, one day I'm going to show you who he really is. And one day I'm going to meet him face to face in a place called in that foreign country.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, Rebecca, I thought about this. Rebecca had a home that she called home. She had a place that she loved to be. But she didn't have the Holy Ghost, and she didn't have the Son in her life.
Right.
She could have said, well, I'm used to eating at Rio Grande every Wednesday. And I go to Walmart on Thursdays. And I've got Bible study on Monday night. And I've got all this stuff during the week. Well, I don't know if I really got time to follow you, servant. You see, that's the world we're at a lot of times. We got all this stuff in our life. And we say, well, if I get a little time, God, I'll come and I'll commune with you a little bit this week. Maybe on Wednesday night I might get to spend an hour with you or so. Or maybe if Sunday morning, if I can get there, Lord, I'll spend about an hour. I'll listen to that crazy preacher for about an hour and see if that'll do me any good. No, this Rebecca, when the Holy Ghost asked her, "Wilt thou go with me to meet this son?" And she said, "Yes, I'll go." And because she realized that her life was never going to be the same again once she had met the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost was drawing her to the Son. You see, that's the job of the Holy Spirit. How many of you know that you can't be saved unless you're drawn by the Holy Spirit? And when the Holy Spirit draws you to the Father, then you must go. You say, really? You got to go? Well, I don't know how it works for you. But that Sunday night on January 31st, 1982, when the Holy Spirit came to where I was at, And he arrested me and said, son, you need to get up and follow me and come to Jesus. I want you to meet him right here tonight. And I got up out of that back pew and I got on my knees in an old altar about 6 miles from here. And I said, Jesus, I'm following the Holy Ghost. He brought me this far. What are we going to do now? And Jesus said, just open your heart and let me come in. And don't let the job of the Holy Ghost to bring you to a relationship with the Son. Rebecca, loaded up her household to be on those camels, what she thought she would need to make her home. And she got on that camel. See, I got a name for them camels. I don't know if the Holy Ghost, I don't know if the servant named them camels. But that camel brought Rebecca from where she was to where the Son was. And I like to call that camel grace.
Yes.
How many of you have been on that camel called grace? Amen. It's brought you from where you were to where you are now.
That's right.
In a relationship with the Son. And so she gets on that camel and they head out toward the land, a far country that she's never been before. And they get almost in the edge of the country, and she looks up and she talks up to the servant. And servant, who is that I see coming my way? And he said, oh, wait, that's the Son. He can't wait to meet you. He's already on his way to meet you. He can't wait to see you. And when she got near to the Son, it said she lit off the candle of grace and found the high favor in the Son's eyes. And they became married that day and became lifelong partners. And the seed of Abraham was through Isaac and Rebecca. God blessed everything that the Holy Ghost went after.
Yep.
You say, well, how does that apply to me? When the Holy Ghost saved you,
right,
he came to draw you to the Son. And he came to bring you by grace to a saving place by the Son of Jesus. And not only did he do that, but he promised you a home eternally.
Amen.
You see, the Bible says that they dwelt together for all of their lives.
Yeah.
How many of you know that you're going to dwell with God for the rest of your life?
Yeah.
All of eternity. But let me tell you, let me remind you, you're not going to get there by yourself.
That's right.
It takes grace to get you there. You say, what do you mean, preacher? You mean I got to ride the camel? Listen, you do whatever it takes to get you to the feet of Jesus. You see that Rebecca, it didn't matter to her if it was on a camel, a mule, it didn't make no difference. She was going to go there wherever the Holy Spirit, the servant led her to do. That's what she was willing to do. Even though she had never seen him, she had never talked to him, she didn't know who he was, but she was willing to go because the servant portrayed Jesus. That servant is still here this morning. That Holy Ghost, the servant. He told her exactly what he was. He said, I am over all of my master's goods. That's what he said. I'm over everything in my master's house. How many of you know that the Holy Ghost is over everything that God has entrusted him with? Even your life. No wonder Jesus said, all who the Father gives me belongs to me.
That's right. Yeah.
Oh, let me ask you this morning. If he were to walk in, the oldest servant of God, if he were to walk in as the Holy Ghost this morning, and he asked you, wilt thou go with me to meet my master's Son? Would you be willing to mount up and go? Would you be willing to leave your old life and journey on a new life, not knowing which direction you're going, not knowing what the future lies, but trusting in the Holy Spirit, a servant to lead you to a place where the Son is? And listen, you ought to be not questioning that. You ought to just, without any hesitancy, say, yes, I'll go wherever the Holy Spirit leads. You see, our problem is we don't want to get out of here and go nowhere. And the Holy Spirit leads us every day to a new adventure in our life. You say, well, I go to Walmart. Well, for some people, that is an adventure. Or if you're like me, I wake up in a new world every day. But I try to follow the servant. I try to follow the Holy Spirit. And where He leads me, I'm going to go. Why? Because I know that He's over everything in my Master's house. And if He's leading me, it's got to be good. It ain't going to be bad. It's going to be good. And if we'll just learn to listen to the Holy Ghost and follow the servant, we'll find Jesus waiting for us with open arms. You see, I read the back. Let me end this. I read the last part of that story. And it said that Rebekah and Isaac were married. And he went in unto her, and they went into their house and ate. So she became the bride of Isaac, the son of the master. And they ate together. In other words, the marriage was consumed, consummated, whatever you say. And they begin to eat together as husband and wife. Can I remind you this morning that in Revelation it talks about the wedding supper of the Lamb?
Yeah.
We're at that table. All the saints of God are going to be sitting, and we're going to be eating with God. We're going to sup with Him, the one that brought us. Then again, I got to believe that Jesus is going to be at the head of the table.
Yeah.
But guess who's going to be on His right hand? That's the servant, the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
That's going to sit there and say, come and die. Yeah. All is made ready. Just come on in and eat with Jesus. Let me ask that question again. Greg, come on, let's sing. What are you going to do with that question? When he asked, the Holy Ghost asked that question to Rebecca, wilt thou go and meet and marry this man that you don't know? What he was really saying is, are you willing to give your life to him? Are you willing to do that this morning? But see, your life is not yours. You've been bought with a price. That price was paid on Calvary's cross. And Jesus said, all who repent and come to me, I'll make them my children. Are you a child of God? Remember what he asked her? Whose daughter are you? He asked you the same question. Whose son or whose daughter are you? You see, there's only two choices. You're either a son or daughter of God, or you're a son or daughter of Satan.
That's right.
There is no way between. I like what the Bible says in 1 Kings. It says, how long will you halt between two opinions? You're either going to serve Baal, the devil, or you're going to serve God. Choose you this day who you're going to serve. Which one are you serving today? You're serving God, or are you serving the devil?
Yeah.
The Holy Ghost is here this morning, waiting on you to take Him by the hand and let Him lead you to the Son this morning. Would you stand and give us a second?
Page 18, His name.
Are you following the Holy Ghost this morning? Is He leading your life? Or have you left Him behind, trying to lead your own life? Oh, you may say this morning, I can do this on my own. I promise you, you can. You need that servant. You need the Holy Ghost in your life.
Jesus,
would you come this morning? Let Him lead you to the Master this morning.
Master of everything.
He wants you to meet the Son this morning. Oh, the Son's here. Jesus is here this morning. He said, repent of your sins. sing in your heart this morning. Are you where you need to be this morning? You see, remember, thought everything was fine and where she was. Until she met the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost moved her eyes into a place that was unknown to her. And sometimes God wants to move us that way. In order to give us strength. To let us know who we really are.
Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus.